أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطاهرين We continue with the verse number 27 of Surah Baqarah الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ أَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلْ وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ Those who break the covenant made with Allah after having pledged it solemnly and sever what Allah has commanded to be joined and cause corruption on the earth, it is they who are the losers. This verse, of course, is the explanation of the fasiqun, which was mentioned in the previous verse, where Allah mentioned that God is not ashamed of giving the parable of a gnat and what's above it. And the believers would add faith by that, and the disbelievers would say, what would Allah mean by this? And then it says many people are guided by that and many people are misguided. وَمَا يُضِلُّ بِهِ إِلَّا الْفَاسِقُونَ And Allah does not misguide but the fasiqun. And this is the explanation or definition of fasiqun. And we mentioned that fasiqun are those who have chosen to transgress, and then that transgression will lead to that misguidance of Allah that was mentioned in the previous verse. Now, these fasiqun are الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ أَحْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ They break the covenants made with Allah after having pledged it solemnly. Now, the covenant of Allah, what it may mean, has been discussed among the exegetes. We have a couple of places where Allah talks about a covenant. For example, أَلَمْ أَعْهَدْ إِلَيْكُمْ يَا بَنِي آدَمَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُّبِينٌ وَأَنِ اعْبُدُونِي هَذَا صِرَاطٌ مُسْتَقِيمٌ This is one of the clearest mention of covenant in the Quran, that Allah has made a covenant with human beings that they would not worship shaitan. That means do not obey. Worship, in the core of worship is obedience, of course. So they do not obey shaitan and they obey Allah in whatever they want to do. This is the clearest mention of Ahadullah. And this is in our fitrah, of course. This is what every human being knows, that they have to follow their creator, because the appreciation of the creator is in our nature, in our fitrah. We know that someone who has done all these goods to us, someone who has created us, we know that he doesn't, of course, want to harm us, and that's why we have to obey it. And shaitan, who is our enemy, of course, we know that we should not obey him. This is in our fitrah. This is what we know. However, this would not be put in place. This act is not going to be questioned from us unless it has been reinforced by a prophet, someone coming and reinforcing this, reminding us of that. So some people say this Ahdullah is an ahd which is taken in Alamu Dhar from human beings. We have made this covenant with Allah and now we shouldn't break it. And Fakhruddin al-Razi and some other exegetes, very rightly, they say that if we do not remember it, okay, suppose that such a covenant has been taken from us in Alamu Dhar, but no one remembers that, so how are we going to be responsible for something that we do not remember? So the best thing is that to say that it is in our nature. Whether that nature is made in Alamu Dhar or afterwards, it doesn't matter. But it is in our nature that we have to obey. But unless it is solemnly reinforced, unless we are requested by a prophet to make that pledge, we would not become fasiq. So if a prophet comes and requests us, ليستعدوه, as it is mentioned in Nahj al-Balagha, that the prophets have come, ليستعدوه ميثاق فترته. The prophets have come to request that covenant, which is in the fitrah of human beings. So unless a prophet comes, we are not responsible, we are not going to be punished even if we violate that ahd which is made in the fitrah, which is placed in the fitrah of human beings. Therefore, min ba'd mithaqih, after it is solemnly pledged, has a very clear function here. الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ أَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ. So if people are not warned, if people are not given guidance through a prophet, then they are not going to be held responsible, although it's in their fitrah, although they have to follow that fitrah. However, Allah, because of his kindness, because of the weakness of human beings that he is aware of, is not going to make them responsible after a prophet comes and requests that mithaq, that ahd, to be implemented. So this is one part of the definition of fasiqun. الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ أَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِ وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلْ. The second aspect of this fisq is they sever what Allah has commanded to be joined. Now, the most general definition of what Allah has asked us to join is the bond between man and God. This is the most, of course, the most general. And if we cut this bond between man and God, either ourselves or we somehow request others to cut this bond, this is a very clear instance of fisq or transgression. However, this has been somehow broken down into different instances, which are instances of breaking bond with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I saw the clearest definition or explanation of this yaqta'una ma amara Allahu bihi an yusal in Faiz al-Kashani's As-Safi, which he also, although alludes to that general definition of yaqta'una ma amara Allahu bihi an yusal, they cut what Allah has ordered them to join, which is the bond between man and God. He says that, yes, there are instances which in human life are somehow representative of this cutting off the relation with God. Now, what he says is, وَيَقْتَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ يُوسَلْ. In his Tafsir As-Safi, he says that, مِنَ الْأَرْحَامِ. Okay, one of the instances is that you cut your relation with your relatives who come from one rahim, from one womb. Rahim is somehow representative of this bond, because people, for example, you and your cousin, you and your parents, you and your siblings, you all come from one womb, either immediately or it goes up and you come from one womb, and therefore they call this salatul rahim to be very important. Of course, they cut off what Allah has ordered to be joined, min al-arham wal-qarabat, relatives, an yata'ahaduhum, that they look after their needs. When we talk about salatul rahim, we don't talk only about, for example, being kind, visiting each other. No, even if they have needs, you have to look after that. This is the true salatul rahim. وَيَقْضُوا حُقُوقَهُمْ. And they, of course, discharge themselves of the rights that they have from them. وَأَفْضَلُ رَحِمٍ. This is what he says, based on, of course, his attitude that we know. وَأَفْضَلُ رَحِمٍ وَأَوْجَبُهُمْ حَقًّا رَحِمُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And of course, the highest rahim and the most meritorious rahim, and which has the highest right upon everyone, is Rahim Muhammad, that should not be cut. That is, of course, Ahlul Bayt of the Prophet, that they should be obeyed, they should not be annoyed. فَإِنَّ حَقَّهُمْ بِمُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ كَمَا أَنَّ حَقَّ قَرَابَةِ الْإِنسَانِ بِأَبِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَمُحَمَّدْ أَعْظَمُ حَقًّا مِنْ أَبَوَيْهِ. Now, the right of Muhammad on us is more than the right of our parents on us. And therefore, the right of his rahim on us is more than the right of our own rahim on us. This is what one of the things he says. And then he says, وَيَدْخُلُ فِي الْآيَةِ التَّفْرِيق بَيْنَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَالْكُتُبِ. Also, فَالتَّصْدِيق. Also, if you separate between the prophets and their books in confirming and approving of it. So, for example, I accept this prophet, I do not accept the other prophet. This is also, you are disjoining what Allah has commanded us to join, that you have to believe, قُولُوا آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْنَا وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ, and all the prophets, we believe in all of them, لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ. So if you do that, and especially this is addressed to Ahlul Kitab, who believe in what is revealed to their own prophet and do not believe what is revealed to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So this is the other one. وَتَرْكُ مُوَالَاتِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and abandoning, deserting the friendship with the believers. Because believers should be friends with each other. Believers should support each other. If you abandon supporting mu'mineen, anywhere in the world, this is also one of the instances of disjoining this connection. وَتَرْكُ الْجُمْعَ وَالْجَمَاعَاتِ الْمَفْرُوضَةِ. Also, if you do not attend congregational prayers, if you do not attend Jummah prayers, this is also one of the instances of what Allah has ordered us to join. وَسَائِرُ مَا فِيهِ رَفْضُ خَيْرٍ أَوْ تَعَاطِ شَرٍ, and anything which is rejection of good and application of evil, or doing something evil, anything like that is قَطْءُ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلْ. You disjoin what Allah has commanded you to join. فَإِنَّهُ يَقْتَعُ الْوَصْلَ. This is the general thing that he says. So all these instances are examples of the general connection that Allah is demanding. فَإِنَّهُ يَقْتَعُ الْوَصْلَ بَيْنَ اللَّهِ وَبَيْنَ الْعَبْدِ. All these would cut the connection between God and the servant. الَّتِي هِيَ الْمَقْصُودَةُ بِالذَّاتِ مِنْ كُلِّ وَصْلٍ وَفَاصْلٍ. What is actually intended by anything that we try to connect or disjoin or disconnect is this relation between God and the servant to be connected, to remain, and any of these things may cut this connection. Therefore, based on what Faiz Kashani says as well, الَّذِينَ يَقْطَعُونَ مَا وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلْ means that they cut the bond between God and the people, including themselves, by doing certain things. It's not just the saying that I don't accept God or I don't believe in God. No, even you may believe in God, but you may cut what Allah has joined to connect. وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And then, of course, after breaking the covenant, after breaking this connection, they cause corruption on the earth. And corruption, we discussed before, what is the meaning of corruption? Corruption, I don't want to elaborate on that now. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. These are the losers. Now, the emphasis here on their loss rather than the corruption that they cause. The loss that they give to others is very interesting. That the first person who is in loss, who is damaged by all these things, is the perpetrator of these acts rather than others. Of course, others would be harmed as well, but the first person would be the one who has done it. And of course, this loss and this khasara appears in this world in terms of misguidance. The heart is blocked from receiving any spiritual thing, cannot think about God. And in the next world, of course, it appears, it unfolds as the fire of the hell. Now, after mentioning this, the verse number 28 asks a very basic question from all human beings. كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا فَأَحْيَاكُمْ ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. How can you be unfaithful to God? Now, this is a very, very basic question that if any human being ponders about it, would, of course, realize that if they are going away from God, they are in loss. How can you be unfaithful to God, seeing that you were lifeless and he gave you life? كُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا فَأَحْيَاكُمْ ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ. He will make you die then, and then he shall bring you to life. ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ. And then you will be brought back to him. This sort of cycle of human life, from lifelessness, coming to life, dying, coming to life again, going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of them are counted as blessings of Allah. Now, one of the interesting things is in the verse is ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ, and then he will make you die, which is counted as one of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why this is a blessing, I will mention later on. But the cycle or the development of human life or human existence is like this. You were lifeless. Now, you were lifeless. It may mean, the exegetes have discussed elaborately on these phases, what do they mean? But generally, we can say we were lifeless in the sense that we were created of the lifeless things on this earth. However, the most specific time of lifelessness, if we can allude to ourselves, is when we were in the wombs before soul was blown into us. So we were alaqatan or mudqatan. We didn't have any life. We were just a very small thing, a small tissue, so to speak. We were lifeless, and Allah blew life into us. So kuntum amwatan. Because if we talk about, for example, clay or dust or food which our parents eat, they cannot be someone addressed as us. But when we are created in the womb as a tissue, then we are, yes, of course, we could be addressed as you. How could you reject Allah? How could you be unfaithful to Allah while you were lifeless? Then, فَأَحْيَاكُمْ, he gave you life by blowing his spirit into us, and that is the spirit of life that he has blew into us, and we have become full of life. We have come to this world, and we grow in this world. Now, we grow old, we grow infirm, and gradually life takes back all the blessings that it has given us, isn't it? And after a while, we really wish to die, isn't it? Death would become a blessing for someone who has lived a long life in this world. And of course, we cannot die unless by the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تَمُوتَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. No soul can die unless with the permission of God. And therefore, after a long time that we live in this world, and we wish to die, and life takes back all the blessing that it has given to us, again, it's Allah who helps us to transfer from this life to another life. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ. Then he would give you life again. After you die, he gives you life again. ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. And then you will return to him. Now, there's one problem here in the ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ. Then you will die, and then he will give you life again. Now, death is not, of course, loss of life. If by life we mean living in this world, of course, death is losing life. But if by life we mean the life of the soul, soul would not die. And therefore, there's a problem here. If we take it in this way, ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ ثُمَّ يُحْيِكُمْ, the soul doesn't die to live again. The soul is only transferred from this world, this dimension, to another dimension. I don't say to another world or next world, because barzakh is another dimension in this world. Akhirah will come after the whole universe is destroyed and Allah would recreate it again, that then the Akhirah comes. So barzakh is still in this world. And therefore, ثُمَّ يُمِتُكُمْ ثُمَّ يُحِيكُمْ would pose a problem. Again, Faiz Kashani mentions this in a very strange way. He says that وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا, you were, of course, lifeless beings, فِي أَصْلَابِ أَبَائِكُمْ وَأَرْحَامُ أُمَّاتِكُمْ, in the loins of your fathers and the wombs of your mothers. That is when someone could address us as you. So you were lifeless. فَأَحْيَاكُمْ, so he gave you life by giving you the soul of life, his spirit of life. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ فِي هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا, then he will make you die in this world. وَيُخْبِرُكُمْ, and you go to the graves. ثُمَّ يُحْيِكُمْ فِي الْقُبُورِ, then he give you life in the grave. And that's in barzakh, of course. So he says that death is dying from this world and finding life in another world. And this pose is called death and coming back to life again. And in that qubur, he says, وَيُنَعَّمُ فِيهَا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَيُعَذَّبُ الْكَافِرِينَ, in barzakh, the mu'minin are going to be blessed by the grace of Allah, by his blessings, and the kafirun are to be punished. ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ, after he makes you die again, your soul die by blowing of the trumpet, and then all the souls come back to life in new bodies. In Akhirah, you will return to him. And إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ means بَأَنْ تَمُوتُ فِي الْقُبُورِ بَعْدَ الْإِهْيَا, you will die in your graves. This is what we mentioned as the blowing of the trumpets. All the souls would die, not the bodies anymore. The souls would die. بَأَنْ تَمُوتُ فِي الْقُبُورِ بَعْدَ الْإِهْيَا, and then Allah will give you life again for resurrection and qiyamah. إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ, you return to him. Now, this is a very standard explanation, that it means you return to his thawab or his iqab, to his reward or to his punishment. Now, what we can say is that dying in qubur and coming back to life is right, of course, because by blowing of the trumpet, we die in qubur and we go back to life. However, ثُمَّ يُحْيِكُمْ refers to resurrection. ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ does not refer to resurrection, refer to the destination after we are given life in resurrection, that we will be returned to him. Now, the whole purpose of life is that we go through this cycle of life so that we go back to him and can live in his neighborhood, can live with him, with God. Of course, don't take this as physical. Spiritually, we can live with God, although we have physical place, but spiritually, we can live with God. إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ, you come back to God. And living with God may be very pleasant for people who are in paradise, and may be very hard and very unpleasant for people who live in hell. Still, everyone goes back to God. People of paradise go back to God. People of hell go back to God. But People of hell, because they cannot tolerate, because of their selfishness, they cannot tolerate seeing the glory of God. They are always in pain. They're always in that selfish pain that they have. And people of paradise, because they see everything from God, they are living in pleasant life. And that would show itself in the outward life that they have as well. But all human beings are going to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the destination. That is what Allah has destined for us, to nothing less than that, nothing less than going back to Him. Huwa alladhi. Now, another thing that Allah mentions as a blessing, if you do not ponder upon this, that you were dead beings, then we gave you life, then we make you die, then you give you life again, and then you come back to us. Even if you cannot see that, look at what we have provided for you. هو الذي خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا ثم استوى إلى السماء فسواهن سبع سماوات وهو بكل شيء عليم. He is the one who has created for you whatever is on the earth. Now, for you may have two meanings: for you to enjoy, to use, and for you meaning because of you. We have created everything which is on the earth because of you. So all the plants, animals, everything are created because of human beings and for human beings. Now, sometimes if we say for human beings, there are many things which are in this world that human beings do not use and cannot use, maybe in future, of course. But if we say because of human beings, yes, because the whole environment, the whole ecosystem of the earth would not have worked without every single thing which is created in this world, from animals, plants, or whatever, that we cannot see any reason for their creation now. There are certain animals at the bottom of the oceans that we even are unaware of it. We don't know. And how can we say that Allah has created those things for us? Yes, we can say because of us, because they are doing a function in the ecosystem, the whole overall ecosystem of the earth, which is created for life of human beings. And that means that human being is the cream of creation. Human being is just like the hadith that says about the Prophet or about Fatima al-Zahra, that if you were not there, I wouldn't have created the universe, the creation. Because, of course, you are the cream. You are the aim of this creation. And this is true about them and true generally about human beings who want to go through that process to become one of the creams of creation. So whatever is on the earth, we have created for you or because of you. هو الذي خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا. And there is one very beautiful hadith from Amir al-Mu'min alayhi salam, who said, خلق لكم لتعتبروا به وتتوصلوا به إلى رضوانه. Do not think that when Allah says everything is created for you, say, okay, so I have to use, enjoy. No. He has created these things for you so that you learn lessons. You find things are invoked in your mind about God. You have i'tibar and tatawassalu bihi ila ridwane. And you use all these things to find, achieve the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is really the purpose of our life, not the enjoyments, the ephemeral sort of things that we enjoy in this life. That is the real cause of creation of the earth for human beings. Now, one interesting thing is that when it comes to earth, God says everything in the earth is created for you. But it doesn't say everything in the heavens and earth are created for you. It says everything in the heaven and earth are controlled for you. سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. As we have in Surah Jasiyah, He has controlled, put under his control whatever is in the heavens and in the earth. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ And he has put under his control for you the day and night. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمُ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرِ He's controlling the moon and the sun for you. So when it comes to the whole universe, it says he is controlling it for you so that it doesn't fall upon you. But when it comes to earth, yes, whatever is on the earth is created for you or because of you. It is for you to use. And some exegetes have here made a very beautiful inference and say that when Allah says created for you, generally human beings, it means that its wealth also should be distributed equally among human beings. If we are actually monopolizing the wealth which is on the earth at the harm of others who are starving, then this is violating what Allah says that he has created it for you all, and you have to use it all. ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ And then he اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ What اسْتَوَى mean? There is a long discussion here, inshallah. I will mention this next week. وَسَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِهِ الطَّاهِرِينَ
Thank you, Anatindi Sheikh. Now we've got about 15, 20 minutes to further the discussion.
As-salamu alaykum, Sheikh. As-salamu. Sheikh, you start off by talking about this promise, this covenant. And you mentioned the covenant, but it's a very loaded word. For example, the Jews say, we have a covenant with God. At the same time, at the other end, we sometimes make personal promises to God. Ya Allah, I promise you I'll do this. If are these all encompassed in the same ayat?
The promises that we make to Allah are different things. This is a covenant which Allah has taken from all human beings. And yes, of course, the Jews have a covenant from Allah. Muslims have a covenant from Allah. This is min ba'd mithaqih. That is the solemnizing that covenant which is in our nature, which comes with a prophet. So a prophet which comes with the Sharia, like Moses, like Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, like Ibrahim and Nuh, and Jesus, which also revitalized the Sharia of the Jews, these are the ones who somehow solemnize this covenant or remind us of that covenant. And when they come, the covenant is now firm. It is incumbent upon us. But if these prophets don't come or don't go to anyone, then although the Ahd is there in their nature, but it is not firm yet. And Allah would not, of course, put them on task for that.
Thank you. Sisters, maybe?
So I don't quite understand that. So you're saying without a prophet, you can't really be held responsible. So you're saying that we don't have a prophet. So if we do things, then we're going to be judged less harshly than people in the past?
We have a prophet, of course. We have a book.
We have a prophet, but we don't have a prophet here.
Prophets cannot always be everywhere, but when the book reaches us and the message reaches us, then it means that the prophet has come to us.
The important
thing is that the message of the prophet reaches a group of people. Then the covenant is firm.
Okay, so you don't need a physical person there
That's
telling
right.
you, you just need something in the past.
Absolutely, yes. Right.
Thanks. Riaz?
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. Thank you very much for the lecture. Sheikh, I just want to go back to this. The very last verse that we were discussing, and I don't want to preempt the discussion for next week, but basically when it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the earth and all that is in it for us, and then he turned towards the heaven, and then he turned towards the seven heavens, it seems sequential, and our understanding of the creation of the world, of the universe, is different to that, and I wondered if...
Yeah, that is why I actually held it here.
Thank you for that.
Because there's long discussion here, what does that mean, that earth was created first and then heavens, and that's why I said we cut here and inshallah discuss next week.
Thank you. Any sisters? No? Brothers? Anybody? Any brother? Yeah, bismillah.
Sir Sheikh, I don't mean to monopolize this. The ayat Allah says, كَيْفَ تَغْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ is referring to the kuffar, I assume.
Yes.
But then he carries on to say, when you'll die and you'll be resurrected. Well, of course, they don't believe this. So how can you use an argument which they don't accept?
Well, God is stating the reality. This is what is happening. Now, the kuffar, of course, accept part of it, isn't it? كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا فَأَحْيَاكُمْ. That's good, okay? ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ is actually, that's a very good point you mentioned, is actually God is stating the continuation, what everyone can see. Of course, ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ, we can see. ثُمَّ أَحْيَاكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ is something that Allah is now stating that His blessings are not going to end there. Because if you think death is end of everything, the blessings would end by death, isn't it? Now, the kuffar believe that they were dead, they were lifeless, they were given life, and then they will die. And God says His blessing is not going to stop there. His blessing is continuous until you go back to Him. So part of it, the kuffar believe. Part, of course, is just a statement of the reality.
Thank you. Any sisters? No, Jimmy.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum.
This thing you mentioned about that the body dies but the soul lives. And then later on, in the other blowing of trumpet, the soul dies as well. If you could sort of explain that a bit more. And if the body dies, the soul doesn't die, does that mean that the education we get here, say we know about Quran and whatever, does that stay with us or is that lost?
Certainly, whatever act we do in this world, which includes learning and all these things, would remain in us. When we die, a new memory is activated in our soul, which we were not aware of, and that's the unconscious memory of the soul, which does not miss anything. Now, of course, we forget many things, and that's, of course, a blessing of Allah. If we do not forget things, then we cannot live. Now, when we die, there is an unconscious part of soul, our memory, which comes into activation by an angel, which is called Ruman, which we will remember every moment of our life in this world. It's just like a sort of recorded thing that would be with us until the day of resurrection, and then, of course, things would change there. So, yes, of course, the education, what we have done in this world, all these things would remain with us and would be like a seed which grows there in Barzakh. We cannot initiate any act there, but of course we will see the consequences of what we have done. They grow and bring foliage, so to speak.
And the other bit about the soul dying as well, so what happens then? Because did you mention soul dies as well?
Yes, yes. The soul, the angels, every living being. And that death is, of course, because soul is something which... concept of death is that when the soul leaves the body, isn't it? But in that sense, the soul die means it goes unconscious, completely unaware of anything. And this happens to the souls, to angels, and every being in this world. وَنُفَخَ فِي السُّورِ فَسَعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْعَارُضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ. Every being on the earth and in the heavens, which are angels, they will die, except a few that Allah wills, which we don't know who they are.
So at the beginning, this death that we have...
So it's just a transfer.
Yeah. So when this Israfil is the one who blows, that's when all the souls die?
Yes, including himself, yes. He's a suicidal blower.
Any sisters? Sister? Yep. Brother?
Um,
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. I'm just wondering, Iran normally leads in discussion of topics that may be quite straightforward in the Qur'an, but yet interpreting it at a different manner. I'm just wondering whether there's any debate at whatever level, scholastic or otherwise, occurring in Iran today about euthanasia.
Yes, of course, there are. Even if you go to websites of Maraji, you will see that there are discussions there, there are fatwas there about euthanasia. And but at the moment, they do not allow it anyhow. Ethically, they do not allow it. Yeah, nobody, no. Yeah. There are articles actually written about it in different journals which come out from Qom, and they are discussing it. You know, these ethical issues which are a product of advancement of new science is very difficult to, especially to find out the ruling of Sharia about them. And therefore, they are still discussing it, but Maraji do not allow it. No, not yet.
Thank you. Any sisters?
What happened to the people who commit suicide?
God knows. We don't know. We don't know. We really don't know how things happen. But we know that it's something forbidden. We know that it's haram. In Christianity, they have a very clear ruling about it, that they go to hell forever. Okay, but I think it's very difficult to issue such categorical judgments about people in very different situations. As I said before, the good thing is that we are not tasked with judging what Allah would do with people. We just judge what is law, whether people violate it or not violate it, but how Allah is going to do with them, we don't know, to deal with them.
Thank you. Any brothers? Sisters? Sheikh, you see, when we take a covenant from somebody, then we expect the other party to be live, conscious, understand.
Yes.
Now, when Allah took covenant from us, we didn't even know that you were existing. So how would he expect us to take a covenant from us where we can't respond in any way? So I know probably it's this is a spiritual matter, but then why should Allah take a covenant in Alamul Zar?
Well, that's what I said, that the exegetes reject that this covenant refers to Alamul Zar. They say that many exegetes say that we do not accept that this refers to Alamul Zar because we do not remember anything of that. And if you take a covenant from someone and they don't remember, you cannot take them responsible for it. So, as I said, this is something in the fetra of human being, this covenant. And it is not solemnized unless a prophet comes and reminds us, as in the expression of Amirul Mu'minin, لَيَسْتَعَدُوهُ مِيْتَاقَ فِتْرَةِ. They request the fulfillment of that covenant. So they remind them, they say, yes, look, you are created by God, you have to obey him. This is something that all of us know, that if we are created by God, we should obey him. So this is the covenant.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
Any other brothers, sisters? Yeah, just a minute. Yeah.
That is the covenant, but whether it is taken in a world previous to this world or in our fetra, that is the question, you know. That yes, Alastu Barabbakum is in our fetra. But we may not act according to it. We may not. Why some people who are brought up in, for example, absolutely atheistic environment suddenly turn towards God, convert to one religion? It's because it's in their fetra. So it's in their fetra which drives them to do that.
Thank you. Any brothers, sisters? Any more? No, thank you, Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.